Good morning and welcome.
Lord.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen?
Amen.
We have service this morning.
Amen.
So it's good seeing you all and looking forward to the day when this can be the norm for an 11 a.m. service and a 9:45 Sunday school. Amen?
Amen.
So we're excited about that. It's good having each of you worshiping with us this Lord's Day. Thanks to all who helped with the food pantry. We still had that last week, as well as men's breakfast. Brother Don brought the challenge for us last week, and we appreciated that for the men's breakfast. We have 38 bags that were given out for food pantry. Thanks to Charlie and Betsy started helping out this month, and praise the Lord for that. Cole, Shea, and for packing the bags. And then Fran, McKenna, Andrea, Cheyenne, Betsy, Cody, Charlie for giving out the bags. So it was a busy day with us Saturday. And then we have the cookies as well. So praise the Lord for those who are involved in that ministry. This coming month, we're going to be doing soups. If you can help out with that, that sign-up sheet is in the back for it as well. If any of you are wondering and saw the bulletin in the back and set it back down because it said February 7th, just cross out the date and put 7/21. Michaela kept asking me each week, do you want the new one printed with the new hymn? I said no, because when we resume, we're still going to have communion. We're still going to do those hymns. So we're being fiscally fit. Amen? So you can all figure that out, but today is the 21st, not the 7th. By way of announcement, continue to remember our sister Pat. Praise the Lord for those that have stepped up and are helping with the meals as she continues to recover. She had a serious break, as you know, in her arm, and just continue to pray for that complete healing, and that certainly the Lord continues to do a work through her and Gary in her healing time, in the healing process. As far as this coming Saturday, I'll be getting over the college class. We are hopefully taking what was collected in the back over to Cedar Lane Missionary Home on Saturday morning. So I'll get a hold of the young people for that ministry as well. I believe everything else is listed. We will have our annual meeting immediately following the service this morning. Whether you are a member or not, we encourage you to stay. You can see how the church is run based on a business meeting, you know, and the tone of the church. So praise the Lord for that. We've never shied away from saying, no, this is probably not a meeting you want to stay to. The door has always been open, and we encourage people to see the life of the church behind the business meeting and those involved in it and the decisions made. As far as midweek, again, we encourage you. Pastor Steve started this past Wednesday night, and praise the Lord for that. And we're encouraging you as a family. You know, one of the things the pastor has said, you can attend prayer, and that does not mean that you need to personally pray. You can listen to the prayers of others and pray with them. But to encourage you to the strength of the church is on Wednesday night. So we encourage you, if it's not ready to come, to do so. We look forward to seeing you even this Wednesday. And Brother Ron or Pastor, any other announcements that I failed to make?
Can you think of
it?
Okay.
All right, Pastor Steve.
That could have been a late announcement coming in. I'm not sure. Mine's good to see you again. Brandon, you are finally here and together. And we recognize some are not able to be with us, but we're sure glad that you made the attempt to join us this morning. And we're going to, as always, start our service by looking to the Lord and asking for His help. So that would be, and let's pray together. Father, we give you thanks for this beautiful day. We give you thanks for the snow. We thank you, Lord, for the safety that has been enjoyed as we've been out on the road from time to time. We thank you, Lord, for the health that you have given to us. And Lord, also we thank you for the illnesses that we have. We thank you, Father, for all things, because all things are in your hand, and you are the sovereign God, and your promises are true, and whatever our situation in life, you are making us more and more like Jesus, and that's the best possible goal that there can be. So, Father, we give you thanks for all that you do for us each day. We thank you, Lord, for the catastrophe that we're in reference to our country, Father, for the disorganization, for the lack of unity. Lord, we give you thanks for that because we know your hand is in it. We know that, Lord, you will turn even evil into good. Lord, your word is very clear. Even those who do something for evil, you can turn it for our good. Amen. And so, Father, we pray for all those involved in the dissension. We pray, Father, that your spirit would reach their hearts. We pray, Father, that you would give salvation to those, Lord, whom you choose to turn to you. We pray, Father, that you would minister according as you see fit for your glory, Lord. That's our goal. That's our desire, that Jesus would be glorified in us, in our service this morning, Lord, and in our country. We pray, Father, especially for those who have special needs. We, again, would remember Pat and Gary. We ask, Father, for your grace to be given and help, Lord, especially with the pain that Pat has. And, Father, we pray for Carrie Jordan. Lord, she has a friend, Tara Raymond, and they have, or she has special needs children. Lord, I'm told that she's not able to get the financial help that she needs from the government yet at this time with disability, and I just ask, Lord, for you to cut through the red tape as you can and to provide for the needs of those children. And Father, we lift up Bill Sr. before you as he is going to be going to some doctor visits and needs some special care for his heart. And I pray for him, Lord, for his family, and ask that you would give peace and strength and your grace. We thank you, Lord, for the answers to prayer with Pastor Lee, that his blood pressure is under control now. I'm sure he's feeling better, and I'm sure his wife is feeling grateful. Ask, Father, for your care for the Mayhew family. We thank you that they were able to hear the gospel clearly preached yesterday, as Glenn shared with them from your word. Ask, Father, that you continue to touch their hearts, and if any don't know you, Lord Jesus, that you might bring them to salvation in Christ. We pray for Doug Flitcraft, Lord, who used to belong to this church, and we understand that he needs some hyperbaric treatment on the 15th of March, and perhaps following that, I pray, Father, that you would give wisdom to those who care for him so that the treatments might be effective in caring for his physical needs. We pray for Barbara's son and wife, Lord, as they have now rejoiced in Reina Elizabeth being born into their family. Lord, we praise you for healthy birth. We ask the Father for your special care for the child, that it would grow, Lord, and come to know you at an early age. Mm-hmm. We pray that, Lord, for our own children. Lord, some young, some old, some been prayed for years. Mm-hmm. Lord, the special request that we have in our heart as we go to you each day and ask, Father, for your grace to be given to our loved ones as we pray day after day, that they would come to know the Savior that we love. And Father, we pray for Steve, the friend, Lord, of Tim Fabig, and ask that you would give special care there as he's in need of second liver transplant. Lord, we don't know all that he has to go through, but we know you'll be with him. And we know, Lord, that you will have your perfect will in his life. And we know that you'll bring him closer to you. So, Lord, we give you thanks for your again for your promises. And Lord, we thank you for the Holy Spirit's ministry in our hearts, even this morning. We pray for the Spirit to accomplish whatever he chooses. We pray that as we listen to your word, that our hearts, Lord, would be stirred to be obedient to whatever you want. We pray, Father, for spirit of unity in our meeting today. We ask that Christ would be seen in how the meeting is conducted, and Lord, and how we live throughout this week. May others see Jesus in us. And we pray, just as in the early church, those who did not know you took note that Peter and John had been with you. And so we pray that those who don't know you, that are our acquaintances, might take note of the difference that Jesus makes and desire to have what we have that peace, that love, that joy, that patience. And Father, that they would turn to Christ and receive Him. We pray these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. And if you would, our call to worship, 82, O Come, let us adore Him. Let's stand together. Funeral or preaching or at the graveside. But God has been good, God has been faithful, and it's because of his saints upholding me in prayer. Amen. I was terrified yesterday, to say the least. But my desire was that God be honored in all things. I had the opportunity twice to present the plan of salvation to family and to friends. And the funeral home, Mark said, you know, he doesn't preach, he sings at funerals. He said, no, we want him to preach, but again, he doesn't do that, he sings. And after it was over, Byron and Mark came over and said, you're no longer Glenn that sings, you're Glenn our pastor. And concluded the service yesterday, but I'm gonna share a text. When I've said to you before, the importance of God lays something on your heart, when he lays it, respond to it, and the Holy Spirit moves. Not at a more convenient time, because you don't know what's going on. The very time I had sent my cousin verses of encouragement for her and Doug and their twin daughters, and she received that is the moment he died. So she had them on her phone, but they never read them together. But yesterday morning, as I was anticipating the funeral, I got a text. It was from Bill, my son-in-law. Said as he was doing his quiet time, these verses were in his quiet time, and he wanted to encourage me with them, and it's how I concluded the service yesterday. I want to share them with you from Revelation. I can read it. I can't. There we go. Revelation 14, verses 12 and 13. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. And to be able to conclude the service at Adams with that passage of Scripture, and to say to them, as Doug was laying here, if I had to ask each of you that were witnessing this service today, could the same be said of you, that your works will follow them? If you did not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, there's a lot of great people sitting in pews of churches that are dying and going to hell. And many were witnessing at that funeral yesterday. And I said, if this were you laying here, could the same be said of you? Or we would have to come up with some glowing stories to make it sound and look good. Doug trusted Christ as his Savior. He accepted the Lord. He humbled himself, and they needed to do the same. That's amazing grace is what we concluded the graveside with. And it was an awesome experience to know that God was in control. However those people left from that graveside, there should have been no doubt in their mind that Doug was different than maybe what was going on in their own lives. So to God be the glory. I praise his name, and I thank you for the prayers and upholding me. I don't even know where we're at here now. Scripture read. All I have to do is follow Michaela's bulletin. And Michaela, the scripture reading is still the same. If you will join me in Acts chapter 4. And thank you for letting me share that with you. Acts chapter 4, let's stand together as we read verses 1 through 12. And I will begin on verse 1. And as they spake unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on him and put them in hold until the next day, for it was now eventide. Howbeit many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. And it came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have ye done this? And then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye lords of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other name, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. The Lord will add his blessing to the reading of his word. Our young people are dismissed for, they're going to be having their class down with Jen this morning and her team. Our hymn of preparation this morning is 364, My Jesus, I Love Thee, 364. Just the first and the last verse, and that last verse will be a cappella. Step for us. We want to be clear about that. The deacons and elders want you to know this is not a permanent solution to how we will do communion, but for the present, it's a safe one. And because of that, we are not putting Doris Thompson out of the ministry. Communion is her ministry. Amen, folks?
Amen.
So that will continue. So I made it real clear to her, as did Ron, as did Don, as did Pastor. This is not to remove you from this role in this ministry. This is hers. But the cup will be all-inclusive. It will have the wafer on the very top under cellophane, and then the actual tab, as you're, if you're pouring a half-and-half little creamer, is what the juice is under. So when you, these elements are distributed to you this morning, the very top piece has a piece of clear cellophane. That's what you'll be pulling back for the wafer. And again, this may not be ideal to you. This is not the way that you want to handle communion. You want the cup, you want the bread. We all agree with that. But we also are cognizant of the fact that we need to be safe in how we're doing it for not only those that are distributing it, but us that are partaking of it. So with that being said, I'm going to, when you get your cup, you'll know it's two parts. The very top is a very thin piece of cellophane that you peel back for the wafer. We good? And that'll be enough that we say about this. And I want to do it before Pastor began communion so we don't have to stop in the middle of that and tell you what we're doing. Amen, Pastor?
Now we're going to have a check on whether or not you remember what Pastor Glenn just told you. What do you not pull first? That was weak. It starts with a T. All together now. Do not pull the tab first. If you do, you will be holding the communion cup and not the wafer, and then you will have one hand with which to somehow take the cellophane off of the cup that you're holding with your other hand, and you will not be able to, especially if you have sausage fingers like some of you guys might have, and then you're going to need to give it to somebody else to do it for you. So don't pull the tab first. The cellophane is very fine. You take that off first, and that's the wafer there, and then later we'll do the tab. All right, now this morning we're going to start with communion, but before we get to communion, I have a preliminary, kind of a preliminary message, I guess you call it, which starts with the word famous. So we're good, right? It looks like a good start. And this is famous mother-in-law sayings, at which my wife is probably thinking, oh no. Famous mother-in-law saying, well, my wife and I have been married for over 53 years, almost. And when we first started dating, she had come home from where she was going to school, which was Perry Bible Institute. Her mother sent her as far away as she could. That was 3,000 miles on the other side of Canada. And it was in Three Hills, Alberta, Prairie Bible Institute. So you know how, I don't know where you live, but streets and housing developments, they're kind of named with nice places like Brookdale. It's by the side of Brook. Prairie Bible Institute is in a prairie. It's just a prairie. And the best thing they could name it is looked around, oh, there's three hills here. So it's Three Hills Prairie Bible Institute, which is now a Bible college, and Franny went there for 2 years. And I missed her when she was going back. I met her when she was home for the first summer after her freshman year. And we started dating, and my mother-in-law-to-be, because I was really feeling sad when she went back to school, she said, Steve, absence makes the heart grow fonder for somebody else. I didn't quite get her point, but this later she followed up with, if you're not with the one you love, love the one you're with. I began to think that she wanted my wife today to have nothing to do with me, you know, and she sent her 3,000 miles away. But of course, that was not my idea. Maybe you've heard this one before. Of course, we had to write love letters back and forth in those days. That's what you did. I don't know what you do. You don't do that now, but you did that. And we're going to burn those love letters, honey, before our children inherit them. I love you so much that I will climb the highest mountain. I will swim the deepest sea. And I will be over to see you Saturday night. And that's a plan. Well, there's no way that I would have said that for obvious reasons. Franny came home in the summers, and my dad's complaint was, do you have to be out every night? Every night. And of course, I didn't say yes, but that would have been my answer. Because every night I was either at her house or I was calling her up. And sometimes when she was off to Bible college, I was calling her up, even in those days when it cost me a whole day's pay just for the telephone call, unlike today. Why? Why was I so devoted? Why did I so much want to see her, to listen to her, to be with her? Anybody have an idea? It's the obvious, isn't it? When you're in love, you want to be with that person. You want to listen to what they say. You want to just be with them. I mean, that's it. You want to be with them. I was in love, and she was always on my mind. No matter whether I was at college, or whether I was working full-time, or whatever, she was always on my mind. Now, there is another verse that I want to share with you. It comes from Malachi 3:16. Then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened, and he heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him. I don't think this is the Lamb's Book of Life. That's different. This is some record the Lord has. It was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. The Hebrew word, to think upon his name, means to meditate on, to esteem, to value, to honor. And you and I honor, esteem, value, think upon the name of the Lord. Can I be perfectly honest with you? Now, some of you, maybe some teenager out there, is saying to himself, no, Pastor, we expect you to lie to us. Well, I want to be perfectly honest with you, and I want you to be perfectly honest with me. I think Doubting Thomas got a bad rap. We always think of him as Doubting Thomas. But he was one who was willing to give his life for Christ, and he said so. Now, you know Peter did, of course. You know he kind of messed up at the end. But Thomas very clearly said he would be willing to give his life for Christ. In fact, he may have been, I haven't checked it out in Scripture, but he may have been the first one. He was also the very first one to say that Jesus was his God. My Lord and my God, he says, when Jesus appears to him after the resurrection. Yes, he said, I want to put my finger in the nail print in my hand in the hole in the side, and unless I can do that, I will not believe. Did you catch that?
Yeah.
I will not believe. That's why I would call him, and not Doubting Thomas, I'd call him Honest Thomas. Pastor, what's that got to do with anything? Well, you may not know it, but I bribed you up a bit to our new pastor. Yeah, I know it's hard to believe, but I bragged about you to him. And I think the only, unless I'm mistaken, the only prayer meeting he ever came to was the one where he was voted in. Is that right? And there were 34 people here.
He didn't come.
He didn't come. But 34 people did. Oh, he was in the church parsonage. Okay. 34 were here because it was prayer meeting night. No. No, it's because something very important was happening. Something very important happens here every prayer meeting night. Do you really believe in prayer?
Yes.
Are you going to be honest with me now? Perfectly honest? Do you really love the Lord? Pastor Steve, you're laying it on heavy. Don't misunderstand and think that I am trying to give you a guilt complex, but I can do that. Ask my kids and my grandkids. But that's not what I'm really trying to do. I'm trying to, by the power of the Spirit, stir your thinking. Do you really believe in prayer, corporate prayer? And maybe you're a great personal prayer warrior. I'm sure many of you are. But there is also corporate prayer. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us any place, and I've read through there several times, doesn't say any place in there that you have to be at church Wednesday night to pray together. But it does give various examples of corporate prayer. One of them is in the book of Acts, not very far from where we are presently. Will you be perfectly honest with me? I know you have all kinds of reasons for not coming. And there are legitimate reasons. Absolutely there are. You may be off on a business trip or off on vacation. You may be suffering from laryngitis or who knows, whateveritis. You can have all kinds of problems and physical needs and not be able to come, and that's perfectly understandable. But have you ever done what I have done? And that's somebody asked me to do something or asked me to go someplace. And I said to them, let me check my calendar. And I go to my calendar, because that's what I live by now, that I'm retired, I can't think straight, and so if I don't have a calendar, I don't even know what day it is. So I go to check my calendar, hoping that I have something else for that particular day. So I call him back and says, no, sorry, I can't go because I've got whatever. You ever been there, done that? It's not that you can't, but that you won't. If the truth be known, I don't have anything on that date, honey. I guess we have to go. And then we, or maybe I think, well, you know, maybe something else will come up and I'll have to call and cancel. You ever tell somebody, well, I can't, because, you know, it's comfortable to say, well, I can't get out to prayer meeting, or I can't do this, I can't go there, when in reality, it's not that I can't, it's that I haven't chosen to. I haven't chosen to make prayer meeting a priority. And that's going to weaken your church. And I think this church is on a growing path. I can see the Lord's Spirit working in your hearts.
Amen.
And I know that power of prayer is necessary for us to go forward. And so I really pray that you'll think seriously about attending prayer meeting. We have valid reasons or just excuses. I heard something not too long ago about excuses. Somebody said excuses are like armpits. Everybody's got them, and they all stink. Been there, done that. Pastor Steve's challenge. Wednesday night prayer meeting. My challenge to you is that you will say, Pastor Steve, I will make it a point to be to prayer meeting at least one Wednesday a month. If you want to come more often, that's great. But at least one Wednesday a month. Let's pick maybe the middle one. And you're going to say, I'll be there. I'll be there on the 17th, or maybe the first one, or the last one, whatever. I'll be there. And then you can use all kinds of other excuses or reasons. I'm too busy. If you want to use that one for the first Wednesday, that's okay with me. If you want to use too tired,
been there, I'd use that one. And probably it's easy to use that one because by the end of the day, I mean, you don't really want to go out to something else. Understand? Just as long as you're still there on the third one. Too cold. And this time of the year, you might want to use that excuse. Too old. But Ron's out to every prayer meeting, and he's 20 years older than I am. So, you know, use it if you wish, even if you're a teenager. You want to use that, that's okay. And by the way, if you are a teenager, don't think prayer meetings for old people. You need to learn the power of prayer while you're young.
Amen.
And I would encourage you to be out and join us. And as Pastor Glenn said, don't think you have to join and pray out loud. Until Pastor Keith comes to these, because I'm going to take over a prayer meeting for, Ron allowed me to do that for next few Wednesdays. And then Pastor Keith will take over. But we're not going to split up in two, and you come out for the first time, and I tell you, you don't have to pray out loud. That means the other person's got to pray for a long time. No, we're going to keep it as a group. We'll have the women in one place and the men in another place. And you perfectly feel, I want you to feel perfectly comfortable. Come out, pray silently. There is a corporate prayer in the book of Acts that I shared with those who came out last Wednesday. And they saw that even though it was a corporate prayer, they didn't all pray it. Absolutely, they did. Unless they all memorized the prayer ahead of time, they didn't all pray this particular corporate prayer. But there it is. The group prayed it, and I would imagine one or maybe more than one prayed part of it, and others said amen, because it was all part of the group praying together. So I would encourage you to come out and pray, and you don't have to pray out loud. Now I'm going to ask if you will bow your heads as we pray in preparation for the Lord's Prayer. And I'm going to give you an opportunity, and I am not going to look around, but if the Spirit spoke into your heart and you realize the importance of praying for your church, for your family, for your loved ones, the importance of corporate prayer, and you're willing to say, Pastor Steve, no better than that, Lord Jesus, I'm going to be out one Wednesday a month, the rest of this year. And I give you my word that I will try my best to do that. And I'm not looking at nobody else's, but to just raise your hand right up and put it right down. I'll give you a moment. Father, you see the decisions of the hearts, and I pray that your Spirit would bless. I pray, Father, that you would make this church a powerhouse for the Spirit to move through it, to minister to those who come, and to minister to those in the community, and to minister to those throughout the world, Lord, through missions. And may we be known as a place where Jesus lives. May others see us and see Christ, and take note that we have been with Jesus. We pray it in his name. Amen.
Amen.
Communion definition, we're about to have communion, and I looked it up, it's a noun. It's a sense of communion with others, affinity, fellowship, kinship, friendship, fellow feeling, whatever that is, togetherness, closeness, harmony, understanding, rapport, connection, communication, empathy, accord, and unity. Nowhere do you see there is eating and drinking. We call that communion, but communion, understand, is the word koinonia. It means something we do together, anything we do together corporately. I would also put a second one in there. It's what Grace Bible does after the last hymn closing prayer. Because I've noticed since I've pastored the church that on occasion I will stand out there after the closing prayer, and you will stand in here. Hey, honey, when is everybody going to leave? Ron's got to close the place up. You enjoy each other's fellowship.
Amen.
That's communion. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
That's a spirit of unity.
Yes.
That's what the early church had. That's a good sign to have. Unity in the spirit.
Amen.
A couple of blessings which we bless, Paul says, in the church of Corinth. Is it not the communion, the koinonia, or other translations we use the word partnership with the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion, the koinonia, the partnership of the body of Christ? It's all of us partaking together, identifying with Christ's blood and Christ's body. Fellowship, association, partnership, joint participation is found 20 times in the Greek New Testament. I know you really wanted to know that, but I pointed it out because I want you to notice the first and last times. The first time is the passage we just studied a couple weeks ago, Acts 2:42. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and koinonia, fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. That's what the early church did. And if you study the book of Acts, you'll see the early church was a very powerful church. In fact, their first corporate prayer, they prayed for two things, and God answered both of them. The last two times are found in 1 John 1, verses 6 and 7. If we say we have fellowship, koinonia, with him, fellowship with Christ, and we walk in darkness, we lie and do not, and the New King James says, practice the truth. The Old King James just says, do the truth. You're not supposed to do the truth, you're supposed to know the truth, aren't you? No, the truth is to be done. Yes, to be known. But if you don't do what you know, then you don't really know it. Those who practice, those who are living in obedience to the Word of God, those who are walking in the light as Christ is in the light, then we have fellowship, koinonia, with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses. Same type of Greek verb, present active, keeps on cleansing. As we keep on doing, as we practice living in the truth, as we practice obeying the truth, he will continually be cleansing us from all sin, for that's his promise. We confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's pause then and inspect our hearts and prepare our hearts for the Lord's Supper as the men come forward. I'd like you to bow in prayer and look at your own heart. Be sure you're right with the Lord. If you're not right with the Lord, don't take communion. If you are, we invite you to participate in this fellowship of the body of Christ. Gentlemen, if they'll come forward at this time. Act Brother Don, if he would give thanks for the bread. And again, I remind you that little piece of cellophane comes off, and then there's the wafer. Don't pull the tab, it'll cause you some difficulty. So, Don, give thanks, please, for the wafer.
My Father, we thank thee for this time, God. I know this is one of your elements. God, we consider it a privilege if we certainly know you in a personal way. Lord, help us to be an example. As 1 John 2:6 said, if we say we're a Christian, we ought to walk as Christ walked. Help us, God, to be that example. Remember, God, your blessings in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. I'm about to ask my wife for help.
Can we sit?
Yes, please have a seat, gentlemen. As long as I hear the crackle of cellophane, we're going to pause. Anybody who's still working, I remind you this just represents the body of Christ, which was given for us. And the Apostle Paul says to the Church of Corinth, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. But the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread." It didn't look like this. It was a piece of unleavened bread. It was flat. Not as flat as this. But flat bread hasn't risen, because God's word is very clear. Leaven is a symbol of sin. And there was to be no leaven in the bread of the Lord's Supper. He says that in both the Old Testament as well as the New Testament. And so they would have a round loaf about the size of a dinner plate and break off pieces. This is my body, it's broken for you, it's given for you. He says, after he'd given thanks, break it and said, "Take, eat, This is my body, which is broken or given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Brother Ron, would you stand and give thanks for the cup?
Oh, our precious Lord and Heavenly Father. Oh, we love you dearly. We thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who was willing to be placed on that cross, willing to shed his blood for us. We thank you, dear Lord. We praise you and we give you the honor and praises due your holy name as we remember what you accomplished there on the cross, that our sins can be forgiven if we trust in you. For it is in Christ's precious name we pray. Amen.
Now you can pull the tab off of the cup. Paul continued on to say, after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament, or the New Covenant in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. So we remember what he did, and we remember what he's going to do. He'll be back, maybe this year. Let's partake together. We did not make any arrangements for the picking up of the cups.
Well, we're gonna ask everybody to take their cup and put it in the trash can.
Take your cup and put it in the trash can, which is right there at the exit, which you can deposit it right after this morning's sermon. Which will be short. Gentlemen, you can take your places again, if you'd like. We are going to finish chapter 3 this morning, and I was planning on preaching chapter 4, but I think we will wait on that. And this is the last point of chapter 3. We're in Peter's message, verses 12 through 26, and we've gotten the answers to those questions earlier. And Peter, of course, says, I didn't do anything to heal this man who's never walked. This is entirely the work of the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Lord Jesus, by the power of God's Spirit through the apostles. And the only question I want to share with you is, who did God choose to bless first and how? Who did God choose to bless first and how? If you take a look at verse 26 of chapter 3, and that's really the only one we're going to look at. You can write down those others if you would like and check it out. But in the last verse, Luke says, unto you first, God having raised up his Son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. God blessed Israel first. First of all, he gave them his word. They had not known sin if they had not the Word of God. The Old Testament law never saved anybody. Scripture says the law cannot save. But it does have several purposes. And one of them is to point out sin. And those of you that have little children, you can do nothing more important for them and to teach them the Word of God. Because until they know they are a sinner, they cannot be saved. Until they understand what sin is. So teach them God's laws. I don't mean all 613 commandments of the Old Testament. By all means, each of the Ten Commandments. God's standard for mankind for all time. So that they know what sin is. And second, he gave them not only the blessing of the Word of God, but God came in Jewish flesh and died not only for the Jews, but for you and I as well, and gave the message of salvation first to the Jews and then to the Gentiles. And you know that, I'm sure, from your study of the Word of God. Jesus said, you wait at Jerusalem for the power of the Holy Spirit, and then you'll be witnesses. Where first? Right where you are, in Jerusalem, in Judea, and then Samaria, and then to the uttermost. Always preaching first to the Jews, and then to the Gentiles. And that's exactly what Paul did as he went from place to place around the Roman Empire, going into cities that knew not Christ whatsoever, going right to the synagogue, preaching to the Jews, and ultimately it was the Gentiles primarily that accepted the message. And that's why you are here this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the Spirit's ministry. We ask, Father, that you would continue to work in us and through us to bless this community, to spread the word of God, to build up the body of Christ, to bring in the kingdom. Help us, Lord, to prepare like you're coming today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. 363, we close. More love to thee. Exactly 12:30. If you must leave,